3 detained militants dead.
The Philippine SIM Card Registration Act now officially a law.
Fatal Russian missile attacks hit Ukraine's capital Kyiv and other cities.
And meet the recipients of this year's Nobel Prize in Economic Sciences.
Good evening, I'm Stanley Palisada.
And I'm Pia Gutierrez.
On our broadcast tonight, a hostage crisis involving a staunch critic of former Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte detained former Senator Leila De Lima, imprisoned over what she claims are trumped-up drug charges, taken hostage, and rescued in an attempted prison break by 3 inmates linked to the terror group Abu Sayyaf. De Lima's camp believes the hostage-taking incident could be targeted. George Carino has tonight's top story.
The cell phone video went viral on social media Sunday morning. It's the scene at the PNP Custodial Center where people can be seen scrambling after the tower guard alerted of a hostage crisis.
Sir! Sir!
The 2 men were heard talking about a hostage crisis.
Hostage daw ata nila si De Lima. Hostage daw ata nila si De Lima. Yung mga oh. Andun nata lahat sila sa ano, kay De Lima. Nakay De Lima sila eh.
During Monday's press briefing, PNP National Headquarters Camp Commander Colonel Mark Pespes says he was at his office at the Headquarters Support Service Sunday morning when he overheard the commotion over their two-way radio. Cops at the custodial center were assisted by the Special Action Force.
Sir, pasok tayo. Pero ano ah, dito.
Teka lang, tingnan. Antayin namin yung ano namin. Antayin namin. Ilan ba ang hostage doon?
3 yun eh. Mga daw yung ano eh. Nang hostage eh.
Anong gamit nila, baril?
Hindi namin ano, nagpaputok tower eh.
While the SAF officer was en route to inform his team leader, another cop on duty arrived holding on to a rifle. Colonel Pespes says he and an officer of SAF were already inside the custodial center around that time negotiating with hostage taker Feliciano Sulayaw. He says the lights were out inside De Lima's room, but they can see the former senator seated at a swivel chair and the hostage taker taking cover behind De Lima. Pespes says the hostage taker was demanding a helicopter, a Hummer, and media coverage that will take him home to Mindanao. The hostage taker also allegedly demanded drinking water, but he refused to drink a bottled water, fearing the drink may be laced with sleep-inducing substance.
Then nag-threaten na siya na by 7:30 papatayin na kita. So mabilis lang na decision. Tapos nung humingi na siya ng bottled water, ng tubig, gusto niya sa dispenser. So pumasok ako sa first room. And then pumasok ako sa may dispenser. Tapos so eto na po, sabi ko kay Sulayaw, ipinakita ko yung half body ko, tapos ibinigay ko yung tubig. Ayaw niyang abutin, then pag abutin niya, lalapit at lalapit sa akin. So ibinigay ko sa table, sa tabi. Tapos nung sinabi kong, Feliciano, malalaglag ito. So nag-attempt siya na hawakan yung baso. Nung nakita kong medyo na-expose na yung ibang katawan niya, doon ko na inilabas yung baril.
The hostage crisis ended when former Senator De Lima was rescued. The PNP says De Lima is now staying at the PNP General Hospital while her cell is being fixed. The PNP also reported that the cop on duty who was stabbed by the assailants is now in stable condition. Police officers who responded to the hostage crisis were honored at Monday's flag-raising ceremony. In an interview with the ABS-CBN News Channel, Dilima spokesperson Attorney Dino De Leon says the former senator may have been the target of the assailants.
I personally, I'm not speaking in behalf of the entire team, but I personally do not discount that possibility that it was the Senator Dino De Leon was specifically targeted. Takot na takot nga sila ng mga ordinary visitors like foreigners going to the to Senator Dino De Leon. Grabe yung security features. Yung pala makakapasok is somebody from the inside na supposedly guarded rin yung inmate na ito.
But PNP Chief General Rodolfo Azurin Jr. believes De Lima was not a target.
Nakausap ko naman po si Senator De Lima. Sabi nga niya, it has been her practice na between 5:30 to 6 o'clock, open na po yung kanyang pintuan because that's the time din na she conducts her regular exercise and morning ritual, specifically yung praying the rosary. So it was really an incidental or it's an incidental na yun ang natumbok niya no ni Sumayo.
Azurin tasked the Criminal Investigation and Detection Group to conduct an investigation. The Chief of Custodial Center, Colonel Patrick Ramiliano, has been relieved as a matter of procedure for administrative investigation. The PNP now vowing to reevaluate existing policies and implement stricter measures inside Camp Crame. George Carino, ABS-CBN News.
De Lima's camp now preparing to file a motion for medical furlough and is studying where to ask for a home furlough or house arrest. This as fears for her safety grow. Mike Navalio has more.
If security was tight the moment she arrived in court, it was even tighter the moment she left.
Any statement, ma'am? Kumusta po kayo?
Ma'am.
Hey, ma'am. Kumusta, ma'am?
More than a dozen police personnel surrounded former Senator Laila De Lima when she attended Monday's hearing at the Muntinlupa Regional Trial Court, a day after she was held hostage and threatened to be killed by a fellow inmate inside the PNP Custodial Center on Sunday morning. Robbery convict and prosecution witness Herbert Colango was supposed to be cross-examined over his allegations against De Lima. But the hearing did not push through because the prosecution moved to have the hearing reset due to COVID concerns. It turns out the former senator had come into close contact with Interior Secretary Benhur Abalos, who had tested positive for COVID. Abalos was among the first to visit De Lima following the hostage-taking incident on Sunday. The defense wanted to proceed with a hearing to avoid further delay. The trial for this drug case has gone beyond 5 years, and yet it's still in the bail petition stage. The defense pointed out the Philippine National Police allowed De Lima to leave Camp Crame to attend the hearing, but the judge agreed with the prosecution. According to her lawyer, Bonita Cardon, De Lima is in good condition, although she suffers from some chest pain.
Ang talagang kino-complain niya talaga sa amin yung may numbing pain pa rin daw sa dibdib. Bunga nung pagkakadiin nung pointed object sa kanya. So may hematoma pa. All possible medical procedures will be taken para talagang totally ma-clear siya.
De Lima will stay for the next 5 days at the PNP General Hospital. Her team intends to file a motion for medical furlough to have her examined in another hospital by doctors of her own choice.
Kami na rin nag-suggest ng psychological counseling dahil na rin sa kanyang sinabi na she underwent a traumatic near-death experience.
In her sworn statement, De Lima said that aside from pointing an ice pick or screwdriver on her chest, the hostage taker tied her hands and feet and blindfolded her. Hostage taker Feliciano Sulayo Jr., an alleged member of the Abu Sayyaf, supposedly threatened to kill her several times, saying he might as well kill her since he and his two companions would die anyway. Because of the threat to De Lima's security, her team is also studying the possibility of filing a motion for extended home furlough or house arrest. Both the prosecution and the defense deny knowledge of Senator Aimee Marcos's claim that there was a prior offer for extended home furlough given to De Lima by the Philippine National Police and the Department of Justice.
We have no information or knowledge about any offer, no? It's possible there is, pero somebody may have made it. But as far as we are members of the panel are concerned, walang coming information.
Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla said the matter needs to be discussed in open court. Although de Lima had previously declined President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s offer to move her to another detention facility, Tacardon said the former senator is just waiting for a recommendation from her legal team if an extended home furlough or house arrest would be good for her. Tacardon stressed de Lima does not want to curry favor or seek special treatment. De Lima has faced her drug cases here at the Muntinlupa Regional Trial Court for more than 5 years. But now comes a new challenge, how to deal with the trauma caused by her hostage ordeal. For some human rights groups, merely transferring de Lima to another detention facility is not enough. Amnesty International Philippines says anything less of releasing de Lima is a perpetuation of a grave injustice. Human Rights Watch also calling on President Marcos and the Justice Department to release de Lima from detention. The group's Philippine researcher Carlos Conde asserts all charges against the former senator are bogus and the right thing to do is to get them dismissed.
Let's remind ourselves here that this case actually progressed because the justice system in the Philippines was manipulated by the former regime to lock her up. So there's no kind of moral authority now by anybody to demand that Ms. De Lima, go through the whole process because the process from the very beginning was bogus. And so we proceed from that. And, you know, there have been recantation of the witnesses, the testimonies of the witnesses. There have been, a few judges have recused themselves from the cases. I mean, that should tell you one thing or two about how this process has been stacked against her. The right thing to do, again, is for Mr. Marcos or the Department of Justice, to be specific, to petition the court to drop the charges, to withdraw the charges. It's it sounds simple, but I think we believe that should be the course of action that the government should take.
The hashtag Free Lila Now also dominated Twitter Sunday. Mike Navalio, ABS-CBN News.
A new law mandating the registration of SIM cards draws mixed reactions among various stakeholders. My colleague Pia Gutierrez tells us why.
Months after being vetoed during the Duterte administration, the proposed measure mandating the registration of SIM cards is now finally a law. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. signed Republic Act 11934, or the SIM card registration law, in a short ceremony in Malacañang attended by lawmakers. Under RA 11934, the controversial provision of an earlier version of the law that requires users to register their social media accounts has already been removed. The measure, however, still mandates all public telecommunications entities to require their users to register their SIM cards using a valid identification document with a picture to prove their identity. This covers not only those who will be buying new cards, but also existing users. Those who will not be able to comply within a given time period will have their SIMs deactivated by their telcos, who are now given authority to do so under the law. Telcos are required to submit these data to the National Telecommunications Commission or NTC, including the list of their authorized dealers and agents nationwide, with information to be updated every quarter.
The use of false or fictitious information, the use of fictitious identities, the use of fraudulent documents or identifications to register a SIM card shall also be dealt with by appropriate penalties.
The president says the law also makes sure to protect the confidentiality of users, as access to the information will only be allowed if the user authorizes it, if subpoenaed by court, or if there's a request from law enforcement agencies in relation to their investigation of a crime.
Truly, legislation is going to be welcomed by many of our people, especially now, with reports of the commission of various crimes using mobile phones, including proliferation of text scams and spam. Indeed, with the signing of this law, we set the important tone that it is our national policy to ensure that technology shall only be used to improve our people's lives.
Department of Information and Communications Technology Secretary Ivan John Uy says telcos will be given the chance to prepare their systems and personnel to comply with the requirements of the new law.
The telcos will just send you a notice na please go to this site and validate, put in your validation na kayo yon, and then take a picture of your ID and then upload it, and then they can verify whether that's correct or not. On the prepaid, they will still receive a notice. Please log into this site, you will receive a verification text on your phone. Now, those who fail to do that probably will be given a few chances to do it over a period of time. Otherwise, they will be cut off.
Globe Telecom says, while it supports the SIM card registration, the national ID system should be first fully rolled out in the country to ensure the safe and successful implementation of the law. Dito Telecommunity, meanwhile, says it will be a great help if both the national ID system and the passport system will be used as the validation of the identity of the subscriber, as this will unburden them of the need to establish a separate biometrics database, which is both time-consuming and costly. Smart Communications, for its part, is asking the government for more time to prepare and test its systems so it can safely implement its own SIM card registration. The telcos say they are ready to coordinate closely with the government in drafting the implementing rules and regulations of the new law. Several Philippine senators lauded the signing of the SIM card registration law. Senator Grace Poe, sponsor of the bill, sees the move as a crucial first step to fend off text scammers. She adds, the law has sufficient safeguards to protect people's privacy. Senator Jinggoy Estrada, who is also one of the bill's authors in the Senate, says it is imperative that the country has laws that are more attuned to the times. But the Computer Professionals Union condemns the signing of the law. The group says, amid worsening crisis, President Marcos is prioritizing legislation that has been proven ineffective in addressing crime. The group also reiterates its stand that mandatory SIM registration puts at risk people's right to privacy and data protection. The reward for leads on the killers of Philippine broadcast journalist Percy Lapid now at 6.5 million pesos. House lawmakers offered 5 million pesos on top of a 1.5 million peso reward from Interior Secretary Benhur Abalos and businessman Alex Lopez. On Monday, police released a new and clearer picture of a person of interest in the killing. The photo was extracted from security footage along Alabang Zapote Road. Camera footage obtained by ABS-CBN News showed the alleged gunman aboard a motorcycle hurried towards the road after last week's shooting. They were next seen avoiding the traffic buildup by counterflowing. Lapid was ambushed near his home in Las Piñas City last week. He was laid to rest Sunday. The Philippines logs over 2,100 new COVID-19 cases Monday. Officials say 837 of this figure were from Metro Manila. Some 33 new deaths were also reported. The nationwide positivity rate on October 9th was at 13.7%. Meanwhile, new cases on the first week of October stood at over 14,300. This was down from the more than 16,000 in the previous week. Daily average cases also declined by 10%. There were also 256 deaths in what officials attribute to late reporting.
Coming up, the winners of this year's Nobel Prize in Economic Sciences.
This and other stories when the World Tonight returns.
We're back in the world tonight. At least five people are killed and a dozen others wounded as deadly Russian missile attacks rock Ukraine's capital, Kyiv. Officials say Monday's strike targeted civilians and hit critical infrastructure in Kyiv's central district. Other explosions were also reported in the cities of Lviv, Ternopil, and Dnipro. The attack is the first major strike into the heart of Ukraine in months. It is seen as Moscow's retaliation to the bombing of a key bridge that linked Russia to the Crimean Peninsula over the weekend. Russian President Vladimir Putin has accused Ukraine of staging the attack.
North Korea says its recent barrage of missile launches were tactical nuclear drills meant to test its capability to hit the South. State media KCNA reveals the tests simulated striking military command facilities, main ports, and airports in South Korea. It says North Korean leader Kim Jong-un personally oversaw the drills, which were supposedly in response to recent naval exercises between U.S. and South Korean forces. Pyongyang has conducted 7 missile launches since late September. It also passed a law last month enshrining the right to use preemptive nuclear strikes to protect itself.
There's no room for compromise over Taiwan's sovereignty. That declaration from the island's president, Tsai Ing-wen. In a speech marking Taiwan's National Day, Tsai compared Russia's invasion of Ukraine to China's goal of seizing Taiwan. She said her administration is making sure Taiwan is fully prepared to respond to external military threats. Tsai noted they are stocking up on precision missiles and other high-performance Navy vessels. Chinese President Xi Jinping, a key ally of Russia's Vladimir Putin, has intensified pressure on Taiwan in recent years. Beijing has vowed to take control of the self-ruled island by force, if necessary.
Malaysian Prime Minister Ismail Sabri Yaakob dissolves parliament, paving the way for general elections. Ismail said he met Sunday with King Sultan Abdullah Sultan Ahmad Shah, who agreed with the dissolution. Ismail added he decided to call for early polls amid criticism over the legitimacy of his government. The elections would come 9 months before parliament's term expires. The Election Commission is expected to meet within the week to announce a date for the vote, which must be held within 60 days from parliament's dissolution. It is likely to be held early November before the year-end monsoon season.
Tragedy in Venezuela. As a massive landslide leaves at least 22 people dead, officials attribute the disaster in the central town of Las Tejeras to days of torrential rains. Rescue operations are underway, with over 50 individuals still missing. The country's interior chief says more than 1,000 rescuers have joined the efforts. President Nicolas Maduro has declared a 3-day mourning period for the victims.
Global shares fell after a series of explosions in the Ukrainian capital. Renewed concern about the economic outlook also sent investors into safe haven assets such as the dollar and bonds. U.S. stock futures connected to the Dow Jones Industrial Average declined 28 points. The MSCI All World Index fell 0.5% in early trading in Europe, down for a 4th day in a row. The Pan-European Stocks 600 also to its lowest in a week.
Philippine shares fall in step with their Asian peers as trading volumes remain anemic. Michelle Ong with the details.
Asia stocks slipped on thin trade on Monday after a surprise drop in U.S. unemployment quashed hopes of a pivot in the Fed's tightening. Investors also bracing for key inflation data and earnings stateside. Markets in Japan and South Korea are on holiday break. In the Philippines, stocks also tumbled. ICCP's Manny Ocampo attributes this to Wall Street's poor performance last Friday, spilling into Monday's sentiment.
No turnaround. Sorry. I don't think it's a turnaround. Maybe technical buying. The precursor to how the market will be today, was already dictated by New York last Friday with New York falling down as much as more than 2%. So that will, come back to us.
For the day, the PSE index fell 1.7% or 100 points to 58.32 on very thin trade, just 2.5 billion pesos. Decliners beating advancers 5-1, with net foreign selling coming in at 240 million pesos. Despite poor sentiment, Ocampo is sticking to his earnings forecast of 10-15% for the third quarter. but says 2023 could be a different story.
No downgrades that we're seeing. I think a lot of the companies are actually doing pretty well, earnings-wise. It's just that, you know, market sentiment is really against wanting to hear any good news coming out of earnings. From a lot of the companies we've spoken to, you know, the recovery, shall we say, the opening up of the economy beyond 2022. That's when people will realize that, you know, maybe there's more uncertainty.
For Kalum Trading Institute's Edmund Lee, while cash is king in the short term, now would be a good time to enter the equities market valuations-wise.
If you look at interest rate differentials, even up until today, they're still far apart. And I think until that gap closes, maybe we might see a more sustainable rally in the medium term. But until that happens, you'll probably see many relief rallies happen in the short term. I do believe markets are oversold, and I really believe like the Philippines are at very attractive valuations today.
Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
OPEC's major oil production cut, fishing pump prices, and here at home, after dropping for 5 straight weeks, diesel prices will see another big-time hike of nearly 7 pesos per liter. Kerosene prices will go up by 3 pesos and 50 centavos, while a liter of gasoline will cost motorists 1 peso and 20 centavos more.
The Nobel Prize in Economic Sciences for 2022 was awarded to U.S.-based economists Ben Bernanke, Douglas Diamond, and Philip Dybvig. Bernanke was chairman of the Federal Reserve from 2006 to 2014 and is now at the Brookings Institute in Washington, D.C., while Diamond and Dybvig are both university professors. Bernanke's analysis of the Great Depression in the 1930s showed how bank runs were a major reason the crisis was severe and prolonged. Diamond and Dybvig's work, meanwhile, looked at how governments can help prevent bank runs by providing deposit insurance and acting as a lender of last resort. The organization says this year's laureates have improved our ability to avoid both serious crises and expensive bailouts.
Our final word tonight is a quote from David Gerold. You can tell a lot about a civilization by the quality of the people found in its jails.
And that is The World Tonight, the 10th of October, 2022. I'm Pia Gutierrez.
And I'm Stanley Palisada from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay.